Dextre's full name is the Special Purpose Dextrous Manipulator. I'm actually glad we call it Dextre instead. And we happen to have, obviously, a model of it right here. And it really does resemble, honest to goodness,
a little person.
A little person with 11-foot arms, with no head and a torso. And so let's, again, just walk us through. We can use the model. How is Dextre going to work?
Well, first, as we saw in the graphics, Dextre is launched in pieces, and its pieces, the two arms, the torso, and the platforms to support experiment, have never been actually hooked up together on the ground because they can't support their own weight if they're hooked up together under the normal gravity of Earth. So this is the first time that Dextre is going to be assembled is in space by the spacewalker. That's going to be quite impressive to see. The arms are on the side. They will be picked up by Canadarm2, which is the robotic arm of the space station, and they will be assembled then and hooked up, connected by the astronaut. Once Dextre is fully connected, it has the ability to change out very small pieces of the equipment on space station. It has the ability, it's so dextrous, that's why it's called Dextre.
That's a good name.
That it can change out pieces as small as a phone book and as big as a phone booth. So this is the range of dextrous manipulation it can do. It has two arms, but only actually uses one, to extract and replace a piece of equipment. What it does with the other one is it will stabilize itself. In microgravity, things get very wobbly. So you need to anchor yourself. Astronauts have to do that even on a spacewalk to not be pushed away from structure once they start working. So one arm will be attached to structure, and the other arm will go and pick up and remove the piece of equipment. It has a platform, so you'll have the new piece of equipment here, the one to be replaced. Take the old one out, push it aside, pick the new one up, and push it back in. We have cameras all over so we can supervise the work of the robot. It can be controlled from inside the space station by astronaut operators or from the ground. And what is really nice is that you don't need any assistance from a spacewalker in order to be able to do this job. So it may be times when it'll be very useful to use the robot to change out a piece of faulty equipment on the space station without having to schedule a long spacewalk. However, clearly it's a robot. It can't think and it can't reason like a human being, so it can't do everything. But for parts of the maintenance of the servicing of space station, it will be very useful.
And of course, the reason you don't want to always have as many spacewalks as we do is because that you are exposing astronauts to, as great as the view as they get, you are exposing them to space. You're getting them outside their home, and having a system like this, you can do battery change outs and satellite work like Dextre allows you to be an options we don't have right now.
Correct. I mean, spacewalks are risky. They're riskier than staying inside the pressurized environment of the space station. But there will be also a task for Dextre to assist during spacewalk. And even on my flight, on 127, the third flight of the Japanese elements, we will use Dextre as a supporting platform. We have a lot of equipment to change out, batteries in particular. And we'll have spacewalkers out there and a robot. So there'll be a team of three.
There's the extra spacewalker we were talking about. Now, you're actually going to get some firsthand experience, pardon the pun, working with Dextre when you're on your flight. How's your training prepared you for that?
Well, the training for a robotics operator is very generic at first. Some of it is the concepts of manipulating a robot is very similar across the various robots that we have in space, the Canadarm on the space shuttle, the Canadarm2, which is on the space station permanently, and we have also a small arm attached to the Japanese pressurized system, and they're all somewhat onto the same configurations. So your generic training prepares you very well to then afterwards really do the specific task. It's like driving a car. Yeah, if you've driven a car once, you can drive another kind of car, even though the switches are not exactly at the same place. The concepts are the same thing.
And we're actually, one of the things that you mentioned a lot of the robotics, except for the Japanese porch facility that you talked about, that the rest of the robotics works have been done by Canadian companies. It's been Canada's contribution to the International Space Station. What does Dextre mean to Canadians and as part of Canadarm2 and the other robotic systems we have there?
Well, for us, the International Space Station, for us all, is an experimental facility. This is the first time in the history of mankind that we built such a big scientific outposts in the environmental space, and that we do it in collaboration with many nations. Dextre is the first ever servicing robot that has ever been designed. So this is something that we don't really know exactly where it's going to be useful. Maybe we'll find and we'll learn lesson about Dextre that will be applied later. And it, even though it is science fiction today, to think that there will be little robots that will be able to go and service our weather satellites and our Earth observation satellites one day, well, it's completely with that kind of robot, the first time that we'll learn whether or not we can do that, and then one day we'll be able to service in space.
These are the first steps. We have to take these first steps and learn how to use it and for other things.
So. That's exactly what Station is about.
And you mentioned this, you're right, it's the international cooperation. We have all these countries working together, and it's one of the things we are learning to do for longer term exploration. You are a Canadian Space Agency astronaut working within NASA. What's that like?
It's like being part of a big family. What is amazing about NASA in particular, because this is where I work as someone from another country, is that it doesn't matter who you are, which country you were born, what language you spoke when you were a kid, what color of skin you have. It is about who you are, your qualifications, and what you can bring to the team. We're a team, and we, the astronauts, we sometimes are the most visible part of the team, but we're actually just a small part of that team. It's thousands of very, very competent, dedicated people behind, the people that design the systems, the people that manage the program, the people that administer, very important, without which everything would crumble. And we're just the ones that go and execute the plan that was designed on the ground. And I never feel like I'm Canadian, or I'm not American, or I'm not Russian. No, I'm part of an astronaut team, and we have a mission to do, and it's a common one. So it's a great job. If you want to sign up, I encourage you.
Probably past my prime, I guess. All right. Well, actually, this is the part of the webcast, which is the audience participation, where people have submitted questions at the NASA.gov for you to answer. And a lot of them are actually related to the number of spacewalks we have, which makes a lot of sense, since STS-123 has 5 spacewalks scheduled, more than any other for a single station mission. So start off with Abigail from South Florida asking, do spacewalking astronauts have to be certified scuba divers, since their spacewalk training takes place underwater?
Absolutely. That's an excellent question. Every astronaut is scuba diving certified, because a lot of the preliminary analysis that we do, we go scuba diving before we put the big suit, which is quite cumbersome, the visibility is restricted. Often we will try to think about how we're going to do a task by going scuba diving, much more easy for us to go around and look through all the angles, and then we design a plan, which we then execute in the pool, trying to figure out if it works. So scuba diving is very important.
All right, and of course, the big pool we're talking about is in Houston. NASA Johnson Space Center has the big pool where you do a lot of the full mock-ups and the training. And
yeah, the closest we get to microgravity, to weightlessness. It's not exact, but it's as close as we get.
And it's at least more convenient than having to wait till you go to space to do it. George from Moon Township asks, how exactly does the tether system work when astronauts do their spacewalks on the space station?
Another very good question. Clearly, spacewalkers are always, always, always tethered to the space station at any given time. For the good reason that if for some reason they would push away from station without holding, if they weren't tethered and they have nothing else to hold on, they would start floating in outer space as their own satellite, and that's not a good thing.
That would be bad, yes.
So the tether, of course, the astronaut is tethered to the station with a reel. And as they move along the station, the reel on reels, a little wire, very sturdy wire, and they check on that wire all the time. We practice this on the pool a lot, to check on your wire, on your tether. It's very important. If it gets entangled, you go and detangle it. If for some reason it curves into a place you don't like, you go and make sure it's all nicely routed, because it's your lifesaver, if needed. However, we do have a backup system.
We do have what we call our safer system, that's got a little jetpack that if you do, I guess, push away or something happens, you
that's right.
Push
and
back
then
to the
you
safe.
Always have the robotics operator. I mean, Canadarm2 has a 55-foot reach. Who knows, if an astronaut would start floating about, then maybe the operator could go and fetch them out of space. But these are really far-fetched scenarios. We've never been there, and hopefully never will.
That's good to have the backup plan, so that's why we do it. Let's see, Gain from Rapid City asked, how do astronauts deal with the fear that must be present at launch? And actually, that you mentioned floating away, throughout the entire mission.
This is a risky business to go and put humans in space and bring them back safely. We've only been at this for 40 some years. It's very recent in the history of mankind. Rocket propulsion has its risk, and we understand them. But that's our job, and the privilege of going to space, the interest of working at such a cutting edge of technology in international collaboration far outweighs the risk, and we're certainly willing. And there's a lot of people that would be. Without risk, we can't advance. We can't discover. I often quote, I wonder if we could go and interview Christopher Columbus today in the NASA news and say, well, you're embarking on this voyage across the ocean, and you don't know where you're going to end up. Aren't you fearful? And that would be interesting to see what he had to say.
Dan from Kenwick wants to know, do astronauts have a hard time sleeping or resting in space? How did you sleep 9 years ago?
Well, first we sleep in sleeping bags because we float. We don't have a mattress, we don't have a bed because we wouldn't be able to stay on it. So in our sleeping bag, we can put our sleeping bag vertical, diagonal, upside down, horizontal, as we wish, and we just anchor it on a wall somewhere so we don't drift while we sleep. We sleep actually very well, and we're so busy during the mission. We work 16, 17, 18 hour days. By the time you get into the sleeping bag, it takes very few minutes before you fall asleep, and it's very comfortable. I slept very well.
So exhaustion helps. Okay, well, that's good. All right, actually, Julie, that was our final question. I wanted to thank you for joining us, and thank you for your insight. We are looking forward to covering your mission, STS-127, next year.
But we've got one going now in a few hours. Go Endeavour.
Indeed. And actually, as a matter of fact, we'd like to thank our web viewers for their participation in today's program. Remember to tune into NASA's home on the internet, www.nasa.gov/shuttle, for live launch and landing blogs and updates throughout the flight of Space Shuttle Endeavour's STS-123 mission. I'm Allard Beutel. Thanks for watching.